अज़ुबिल्लाहि मिनश्शैतानिर्रजीम बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। सो इंशाल्लाह वी विल लर्न फ्यू मोर आयत्स ऑफ सूरह अल-कहफ टुडे फ्रॉम आयत नंबर 78 टू आयत नंबर 80। द आयत नंबर 78 इज़ ए कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ व्हाट खिज़्र अलैहिस्सलाम इज़ टेलिंग मूसा अलैहिस्सलाम अबाउट ऑल द efforts that he has exhausted now and could not have patience. Musa alayhi salam could not display any patience on what he was doing. So Khidr alayhi salam is speaking in the beginning of ayat number 78 by saying, "A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim." Qala hadha firaqu bayni wa baynika. He said, Khidr said, this is the time. It's a separation or parting between me and you. Then he further said, "Sa'unabbi'uka bita'wili." I'm definitely going to tell you soon, inform you the interpretation, the reason, ma lam tasti' alayhi sabra, of what you were not able to have any patience about the things that he did. So in the next ayat, he is starting explaining that what were the things that he did and why did he do. So the first thing he mentions, amma safinatu, as for the boat is concerned, fakanat li masakina, it belonged to some people who were poor, miskin, masakin. Ya'maluna fil bahri, they used to work in the rivers or by the ocean for earning their livings. So for aradtu, so I intended, Khidr is saying that it was my intention, an aibaha, that I make it defective. Wa kana wara'ahum, and there was on the other side of them, these people, and this is the on the other side of the river, malikun, there was a king, Ya'khudhu, he was taking, kulla safinatin ghasba, every boat or ship that was arriving there by force. So he was snatching those things from the people who used to earn their living by traveling or by working on the boat or in the ocean. And then he gives the explanation that why he killed the child. In the next ayat, wa ammal ghulamu, and as for the boy that Khidr killed, fakana abawahu, his parents were mu'minaini, the believers, fakhashina, so we feared, an yurhiqahuma, the boy he killed would oppress both of them, his parents, tughyanam wa kufra, by rebelling and by doing the disbelief and kufr. So when the boy grows up, he will be a hassle, a problem for the parents. So it was decided that child should not be there anymore. Then inshallah we'll continue the other reasons after that. So going back in the beginning to understand the details of these ayats, the word qala is being spoken by Khidr. He said, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is quoting Khidr, that Khidr was saying something, and what did he say? Hada firaqu bayni wa baynik. So let's try to understand these words. Hada is used as a isma ishara, pointing to something, and this haza is pointing to all the three things that Khidr did to in front of Musa alayhi salam. So after that he says, now this is the time, haza, this is the time, this is the place, firaqo. So the word firaqo originates from the root letters faraqa, and faraqa means to separate something or to part from something. Farq is to separate two things. So faraqa, Firaqun is the noun, and firaqun means separation or parting of two parties or two things. Always the noun ends with the two paish or two dhammas. So firaqun means separation, and he is pointing the separation between himself and between Musa. So how the work is going to work between the next two words? The next word is Bainun. Bainun means between. Okay. Then we combine this with a Ya. Bain means between. And Ya means me. And me is pointing, he's pointing to himself. Khidr, this me is being used for Khidr, himself. So when you combine these two as mudaf, mudafilay, this pronoun does not change, but only one dhamma goes away. So it becomes Baino and Ya. Okay. So now what we have to do, so typically we put an off to make mudaf mudafile, but again the work before that is firaqun. Firaqun is a separation, so we have to make a double mudaf mudafile here. So now you combine these two words, firaqun and bainu. So when you do that, as a rule, one dhamma goes away from firaqun, so it becomes firaqo, and that's the word in the Quran. In the second noun, this dhamma changes into a kasra to bring the concept of off. So it becomes firaqo bayni. So these are exactly the words in the Quran. Separation between me. Up to this point, the separation between me. Now, I'm going to keep everything same except this word, this last letter, I'm going to replace by ka, which means you. Every rule will apply there. You start with Bainun, you start with Firaqun. But this time it is Ka. So after all those changes, it will become Firaqo Bainika. Okay. So the meaning, the Firaqo is going to apply to both of them. So the literal meaning will be Firaqo, a separation or parting between me and between you. But in English we don't have to repeat the between twice. So the meaning will be firaqo baini wa bain, even though bain is coming twice, which means between. But in English we don't have to speak that. English it will be firaqo, a separation between me and you. Okay. So to simplify and correct English, we don't have to translate bain twice, even though it's coming in the Arabic language. So he's saying now we are going to separate. But before I that, sa'unabbi'uka. So here this is made of three different words. So first thing is seen, and I'll explain what seen does with a fataha. And the last letter is ka. Ka means you. And the root letters are noon, ba, and ya. Okay. These are three root letters. It has multiple meanings, but actually we want to go bab number two, fa'ala. In fa'ala, we put the middle letter twice. So it becomes middle letter nabba'ya. Nabba'ya means to give news, to inform someone. Okay. So that is the root letters, nabba'ya. Okay. So we have to use these things. Now, in the rule of the grammar, if you put an alif in the beginning, it becomes I do. Af'alu, I do. So if I put an alif in the beginning, it will bring the meaning of I inform. And this I inform covers both present tense and future tense. So this will become O Nabbi O. So the grammar will be O Nabbi O. Okay. Now, because this word in the middle, unabbiu, is mudare, it covers both present tense and future tense. But this scene in the beginning does extra change in here, and it keeps only in the future. It takes out the present tense. So the letter seen defines the future only. So the meaning will be sa'unabbi'uka, I will tell you. Okay. So Khidr is saying, I am going to, or I'm going to tell you in the near future, means right away. What am I going to tell you? Bita'wili ma'alam. So let's look at the next word. The next word is again made, so let's start with the root letters Alif, Waw, and Lam. These are the root letters Alif, Waw, Lam. And again, we have to use the same bab number 2, put a shadda, and it becomes awwala. Awwala, as we know, typically in the meaning is to be the first one, but it has multiple meanings. One of the meanings is to interpret something. Awwala means to do the explanation, interpretation of something. So we are going to use that meaning here. Now, remember, in like, okay, here's the example. If you have these three letters, Ain, Lam, with a shadda and meem, allama. Allama means to teach. If I put a ta in the beginning and pronounce ta'alimun, so ta and a ya, it becomes the activity of this word, ta'alim. Allama means to teach. Ta'alimun, full word is ta'alimun, means activity of this action, which is the teaching, allam, ta'alim. Apply the same rule here. You put a ta in the beginning, and alif is there, waw is there, you put a ya, just like you put these two things, ta and ya, and lam. Ta'awilun. So that this is the word. Ta'awilun means interpretation. Awwala means to interpret. And ta'awil, when you stop, we say ta'awil, but the full word is ta'awilun. Ta'awilun means the activity of interpreting something, which is interpretation in English. So this is the starting word, but it is not all, but there are a couple things happening to this word. But first of all, the word is ta'awilun. So let's start with that word. Two things are adding in this word. One is ma, and one is b with a kasra. So we have to combine all these three to bring the proper meaning of the sentence. Okay. So ta'awilun means interpretation. Ma means that or what. Now, first thing you do, you combine these two together by putting an off, which is the rule of izafa, mudaf, mudaf ilayh. So the meaning will be ta'awilun is one word and that is the other word. By putting an off in between, it removes one dhamma from there, so it becomes only ta'awilu. Ta'awilu, and this is pronoun, pronoun don't change, so ma will remain ma. Ta'awilo ma, just these two words mean interpretation of that. We'll see what that is. But then you have a B in the beginning, which brings the meaning of with or of or about. So the best word is here about. Okay. B is a harfijar. Harfijar will look at the next word and will change this dhamma to a kasra. So now these are the exact words in the Quran. Bita'awili ma. The inter of the or about the interpretation of that. Now what is that pointing to? Whatever activity has taken place in the journey so far, that this is pointing to that. So Khidr is saying, Sa'unabbi'uka, soon I'm going to inform you, bita'awili ma, about the interpretation of that thing which took place so far. Now, he is adding another statement after that by saying, lam tastati alayhi sabra. So let's look at these words here. First of all, this has come a few times, but here is one more thing happening in this case. So root letters are ta, vau, and an. Ta, a, vau, and an, and these are bab faala. In this case, we are going to bab number 10 by adding an ist in the beginning. So this becomes ist, ta, and when you combine the word, this vau will have a fatha, will changes into an alif. So the word becomes istata'a. Istata'a. And we know the word istita'at. Istita'at means to have the ability. This has come multiple times. So this is the starting word. Istita'a means to have the ability, capability of doing something. Istita'a. So if you are using, you're talking about a second person, taf'alu, you add a ta in the beginning and it becomes you do. So ta brings the meaning of second person. So if I add the ta here, it will become tastati'u. Important thing is that the sound is tas, ta, ti. There is a ya and ayin has a dhamma. So tas, this is, if the word is by itself, the sound will be tas, ta, ti, o, and the meaning will be you have the ability of doing something. It's a positive statement. Tafalo, you do. Tastati'u, you have the ability to do something. Now we are going to apply the ya lam before that. Lam does three things that I have explained a few times, but it's important to know one more time. Lam brings the meaning, first of all, not. Okay. Second thing this lam does, it looks at the last letter and changes this dhamma to a sukoon or a jazm. Okay. And third thing it does, it pulls the meaning in the past tense. So the meaning will be, you were not able to. Tastati in the beginning was you were able to, but now it becomes you were not. Tastati means you are able, it's a present tense, but now it is pulled in the past tense. You were unable to. Another important thing that happens is that if you look at the last two letters, ya and ayn, both have jazm or sukoon on them. If you have two alphabet letters next to each other, both have sukoon, you cannot pronounce them. So in order to pronounce them, we have to fix these last two letters. And easy way to fix is that this ya has a sound only, of sound of E. So we throw away this ya, this letter, ya, we throw away. And if you notice that after you throw away, what is left is exactly in the Quran. There is no ya in the Quran before. So this is just the T. Yeah. So, Lam tastati' means you did not have the ability to. Which means he's telling, Khidr is telling Musa alayhi salam that, and using the word sabr after that. So he said that you were not able to have patience. Sabrun, but it's coming as a maful of tastati, so it's a sabran, stop, say sabra. Alayhi, about which or about that. And this is pointing to all the incidents that happened. So Khidr is, alayhi salam, is saying two things. He says, now we are going to apart away. We are going to separate. Second thing, I will tell you what the interpretation of all these things are that I did. And third thing is saying, these were the things you were not able to be patient with me. Alayhi sabra, upon these things or about these things, you were unable to have any patience. So what happens after that? He, Musa alayhi salam, doesn't say anything. He just stands there and he listens to him. So he started telling him Because the thing is that if you recall the ayahs before that, this was a contract between, last contract was that if I ask anything anymore, you can separate me. So, فَلَا تُصَاحِبْنِي, do not give me company anymore if I ask any more questions. So Khidr is actually satisfying the contract that was previously made between Khidr and Musa, that if I ask any more, that's all. So Khidr said, okay, you ask one more time, and that was it. So now you and me have to separate, but I'm going to tell you the meanings and the interpretation of the things. The important thing is that the word ta'wil, we sometimes use, especially if some incident happened and other person is unable to understand, and the person who is doing, then he gives an explanation, and actually the word interpretation in English is very close to the word ta'wil. So now he's telling, the word starts with amma safinato, okay? Amma is, this word is just one word, not two, and it is used when you are starting a sentence. In English, a translation is as for. In Urdu, there are many words you can use. Aur ye ke, ya jaise ke, aur isi tarah se. There are many words in Urdu. In English, it is as for. Means as far as something is concerned, okay? Isi tarah se. So that's the meaning of amma. The next word is safina. Safinatun is the word, which is a feminine word, because last letter is a ta marbuta. Most of the words which have last letter is a round ta are feminine. So when you put al, it becomes as-safinatu. So he's saying, as for the boat is concerned, why did I make a defect in that board? The reason is fakanat. Now here important thing is that the root letters are kaf, waw, and noon. Kawana, this means to be or to belong to, okay? So if you are making the grammar of past tense, it is kawana, and this sound alif, the waw and fata will sound into alif, so kana. Kana means it was or it belonged. But when you put a ta at the end, it becomes the grammar of a feminine word. So kanat, she was, or she belonged. Okay. Why feminine is being used? Because safina is a feminine word. As I said, last letter is ta marbuta. Ta marbuta is a sign that the word is a feminine word. So if you have a feminine word, you use the grammar of something happening to that feminine word, then you have to use kanat. Fa means so, okay? So it belonged, that's what it is saying. As far as the boat is concerned, it belonged, okay? It's a past tense. Belonged to whom? The word is sakana, and it has multiple meanings. It means to reside. Sakin is a person who is stable, who is residing. Sukunat is resident. But miskeen, when you put a meme in the beginning, miskeenun is means a person who is a poor. And the word is miskeenun. Full word is with the two with dhammas at the end. Miskeen is a commonly used as miskeen is a poor person who doesn't have much resources. It's a singular. To make the plural, the word becomes masakin. All you have to do is change these two into the sound of masakinun. Masakinun means the poor pupil. Okay. Now, when you put a lam before that, it means two or four. Okay, so lam will change these two as a kasra. Okay, but what will happen? I want to explain this thing a little bit more detailed. In the plural, For example, when you have any word, it changes in three states: two zabar, two dhammas, two kasras, or two fathas. Okay. But there are some words which only change twice, two things only. Okay. And one of them is the plural. For example, samawat. Samawat to. So what I was saying is that there are some words in Arabic which don't change three ways, and these are called the states of the words. They call rafa, nasab, and jar, which means two dhammas, two kasra, and two zair, two fathas. But there are some words, for example, I was saying samawat. Samawat is a plural, it's a feminine word. It only changes samawati and samawato. You will not see samawata in the Quran. Okay. Likewise, the word which are plural words, which are made by the noon, like mu'minuna, mu'minina, you not will see mu'minini. So that's what happens in this case also. This is a plural, and so it will change only to fataha, even though it's a jar, but jar does not bring kasra, it brings only fataha. So that's the rule of the grammar and vocabulary. So, but anyway, regardless, the meaning is limasakina, to the poor people. The boat belonged to the poor people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says right after that, ya'maluna fil bahari. So ya'maluna is from amala. Amala means to do. And ya'maluna, they doing. They are doing, or they were doing. Means doing means they were earning their living. They are working. Fil bahari, these are common words. Baharun means waters or ocean or wherever that river was. Baharun is the word. And then you put al, the waters. Al will remove one dhamma, so it will become al baharu. And fi means in or on. And this is a harf-e jar, it will change to this kasra last letter. So fil bahari, you don't pronounce this alif after that. It becomes hamzatul wasl. So final word is fil bahari. Ya'amaluna fil bahari, they used to work in the waters, means in the ocean or river, for earning their living. So they may be fishermen or transporting people from one bank to the other bank, or for other reasons. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that though that boat belonged to the poor people, so then the word after that, fa'aratu. So let's understand that word. Ra, waw, and dal are the root letters. They belong to Bab-e Fa'ala. Okay. We were going to go to Bab-e Afala, which is number 4, by putting alif in the beginning. So it becomes alif, ra, waw, dal. Okay. So when you put the harakat, the sound of the waw will change into the alif. So it becomes arada. Arada that we use in Urdu, irada means intention. That is the noun. But arada means to make the intention. So this becomes arada. Arada means to intend something or to make an intention about something. So that is okay. Now, the rule is that if you have three letters, fa, and lam, and you put a ta at the end with a dhamma here, fa'altu, this brings the meaning of I and did. Okay, fa'alam is to do. So fa'altu brings the meaning of I did. So we are going to apply that grammar here. So this will keep fa separate. That's not part of that. And it becomes arad to. Important thing is that the tajweed changes few things. The word is arad to. Okay. Alif has a fatha, or hamza with a fatha. Ra combines with dal, rad. And last letter is ta with a dhamma, and this is the one that's bringing the meaning of I intended. In the tajweed, dal and ta have very close makharij. So what they do, instead of pronouncing dal, they pronounce ta two times. So if you do that, you put a shadda on this ta and you remove the jazm or sukoon from there. So da is just sitting as a letter, but it is not being pronounced. So the pronunciation is arat tu. Rata has to be pronounced twice. And that's how it is in the Quran. Arat tu. I intended. Okay. Fa arat tu. Then I intended. So Khidr is saying that the boat belonged to the poor people. They used to work in the waters. So I intended. So this was my intention. That's what he's saying. What was the intention? An'a'ibaha. Common words, but it's just the vocabulary and the grammar. First of all, an has certain things that it does. An means that, but it also does one more thing. It has some effect on the next word after that. Okay, so root letters is ayn, ya, and ba. Okay, we know the word aib. Aib means defect. Okay, so ayn, ya, ba means to make a defect in something. Okay, now when I apply the alif, it becomes the grammar af alu, I do. So we are going to apply that grammar here. Af alu, by putting an alif in the beginning with the three letters, it becomes I and present tense, I do. So this becomes a-a-yabo. To begin with this, a-a-yabo means to, I made a defect, or I made something defective. Now what will happen? First of all, it is hard to pronounce a-a-yabo. So what the Arabs did, they said, okay, if I move this zabar or fataha on the letter before and made the sukoon this way, it become a-ibo. It becomes easy to pronounce. So first thing they did, pronounced is a-ibo. The sound is ya. But then they further said that if I am pronouncing, so I'll put another hamza there. So that's the correct in Osmani language. So a e bo. But because of this zabar or fata sound, they also pronounce this is okay. This is the sound of ya. It goes under there. So this sound of ya goes here. Okay. And this sukun comes here. Okay, so a-ibo. A-i-bo, that is the final word. Now what happens? A-i-bo, or any word, when we make, is both present tense and future tense. Af-alo, I do, or I will do. Okay. Now, when we put this an in the beginning, it does a couple things. It brings the meaning that, which is the as a result of that, of which is a result is meant, I wanted to make an intent, it was my intention. So to implement the intention, the word un is being brought there. But un does one more thing. Un looks at the next now, the verb, and changes this to a last letter to a fataha. And brings the meaning, instead of I do, you can bring the meaning I should. I intended that I should make a defect. It was my intention to make a defect. So that is an-a-i-ba. That's the word in the Quran. Ha is pointing to the boat. It's a feminine word. An-a-i-ba-ha. So faratu. So I intended. An-a-i-ba-ha. That I should make it defective. Or should create a defect in this boat. Okay, so that's what he did. he made a hole there in the boat and he made it defective so it could not sail anymore in the water. Why he's saying, now he's giving the reason that why did he do that by saying, Vakana vara'ahum. First of all, vara'un is a word. This means on the other side. This is also used in Urdu also. Ma vara or something. Vara'un means on the other side of something. Okay, other bank of the water. Okay, then you combine with whom. Whom means the people on the boat or the people who used to work on the boat, ya'maluna. So what he's saying, that if the boat had sailed, these people would have reached on the other side, wherever they were, their destiny was, crossing the river and arriving on the other side. So when you combine these, mudaf mudafile, you remove one dhamma, it becomes vara'uhum. Vara'uhum means on the other side of them. Vara'uhum. Important thing is that we started with two dhammas, but by combination of mudaf mudafile, it became one. Now this whole word is coming after kana. Kana means was, or there was. And this is coming as a maful or a khabar, and when it happens that kana changes this to a fataha, so it becomes vara'ahum. And there was on the other side of them. Who was there? Malikun. Malikun means a king. Malik is a king. Full word is Malikun. So there was a king. There was a ruler on the other side of the waters and the ocean. What he was doing? Ya'khudhu kulla safinatin ghasba. So akhaza are the root letters. Alif, kha, and zal. This means to take. Okay, you apply the word yaf'alu, he does. Ya'khuzu, he took, or he was taken. Okay, so that is straightforward grammar. Ya brings the meaning of third person. Okay, and present tense, yaf'alu, he does. Ya'khuzu, he takes. He takes means he was taken. So this becomes ya'khuzu. This is sukoon. Hamza with a sukoon and khuzu. Ya'khuzu. He was taking, the king was taking. What was he taking? Kullun and safinatun. These are two words. Kullun, so original word is kullun means each or all. Important thing is that when you start, the word is kullun. When you start this thing was safinatun. Original words are always two pesh or two dhammas. Safinatun. Safinatun has two dhammas and kullun has, so it has a shadda, kullun has two dhammas. When you combine these as the rule of izafa by putting an off in between, the first word loses one dhamma, so it becomes kullu. Second one changes two dhammas to two kasras. So the combination is kullu safinatin. The meaning is that each or every of the boats or the ship. But this whole thing is coming as the maful of ya'khuzu. Ya'khuzu, he was taking. Okay. So when a noun comes as a maful or object of a verb, then the last letters dhamma changes to fataha. Khalaq al-insana. He created the man. Insano became insana. Kullo becomes kulla. Ya'khuzu kulla safinatin. Those are the words in the Quran. He was snatching, he was taking away every safina, every boat that was arriving on the other side. And then the next word is ghasban. Ghasban is from the root letters ghain, swad, and ba. Ghain, swad, and ba. The meaning of it is that to apply some force. Okay. Noun is ghasbun. There is another word with the duad here that has a different meaning. That is ghadab, that's anger. But this is ghasab. So noun is ghasbun. Ghasbun means force. Okay. Now this is coming as ya'khudhu kulla safinatin ghasban, because it is coming as a maful of ya'khudhu. So ghasbun, two dhammas will change to two fathas by the rule. And whenever you have two fathas there, you add an alif in there and pronounce ghasban. When you stop, you pronounce ghasba by force. So he was taking away every boat which was arriving on the other side by force. So what Khidr did, he made a hole. That means boat could not sail anymore. People had to get off, and later on they must have fixed the hole in there. But this way the boat never went on the other side, and the masakin did not lose their boat as it was being taken away by the king. Then it explains the next part of it. Wa amma al ghulamu. The same words. Wa amma. Wa means and. Amma means as for. Al ghulamu. The boy. So as far as the story about the boy goes. Fakana abawahu mu'minaini. So here. Word is ghulamu means is boy. Fakana. Fa means so. Kana means he was. The boy was, it's pointing to the boy. The next few words are alif, ba, and waw. These are the root letters. And we make the word abba. Abba is father, okay? But when you make a plural, for example, when you have a word walid and walida, when you set them together, you say, walidain. So dain, yain, the sound of yain is the plurality of two people. Original word, first time when you make, the word is walidan. But grammatically, when it is used, it becomes walidain. But in Urdu, we took the grammatical part, not the original part. We in Urdu we call walidain. Actually, this is the walidan is the actual word. Okay, but when it goes through in Arabic through the grammatical effect of the other words, then it changes to walidain. So we should have in Urdu taken the word walidan and used it, but we took walidain. But that's a different thing. That's how languages are created. So abawan. Abawan means parents, both father and mother. Walidan, you put in an alif and noon, it becomes the plural of two, both of them. So abawan, okay. Now, so remember the word is abawan, okay. Now, who? Who is pointing to the boy? Him, okay. And these abawan means parents. Now we want to do is want to put a off in between and make a relationship between boy and parents. So it will be boy he of those parents. Okay. So when you apply the rule of mudaf mudaf ilayh on this one, pronouns don't change, but on the noun, the remember that when you have two pesh, kitabun, when you make mudaf mudaf ilayh, sound of noon goes away, kitabuhu, his book. So sound of noon, in this case it is actually noon, so that goes away. So it becomes abawahu. That's the word in the Quran. Abawahu means his parents. Okay. It's, you know, it's kind of not word is used in Urdu. Abawahu. Okay. Means his parents. So the rule is that because it's a plural of two, instead of a tanween, there is actually noon there. But when you make the rule of combining two words together, that noon falls off. Like Tanween changes into one pesh, noon goes away. Abawahu, his parents. Fakana abawahu, so his parents were. The next word is mu'minaini. Again, the plural of two. The word singular is mu'minun. And waw is not pronounced, so it is pronounced mu'minun. One mu'min is called mu'minun. If you have many believers, then you add a waw and noon, so it becomes mu'minuna. We use this all the time, mu'minuna. But if there are only two believers, then you do not use waw, you use alif. And when it changes, it becomes ya. Mu'minina. Mu'minaini. So, mu'minaini is the grammar of two plurals. Mu'minuna, mu'minaini. Okay. So, that is, his both parents were believers. Okay. So, he's saying that as far as the boy is concerned, his parents were believing moments. So what happened after that? Fakhashina. So kha, sheen, and ya. Khashiya. This means to fear. We also use khashiyat. You know, we should have khashiyat in our prayers. So khashiya means to have fear about something. Okay. Khashiya, and we apply the grammar of fa'alna. Fa'alna means we did. Khashina, we feared. So Khidr is saying that we had this fear about something. And he's explaining what was that fear. Khashina, we feared. Fa means so. So we feared. His parents were believers. So we had some worries about something. Khidr is saying about this, the boy and about the parents. Fa khashina. So what did we do? And what was the fear? He's explaining what was the fear. Fear is coming from the next three letters, raha qaf, raha qa. Okay, this is bab fa'ala. We apply bab afala. Arhaqa. Arhaqa means to oppress someone, to give someone difficult and hard time, to have to make life miserable for someone. Arhaqa is used in many of those words, okay? So, when you make the grammar of third person, you apply a ya in the beginning. So, this will become yurhiqo. When you put yur, alif is not used. So, it becomes yurhiqo. Yurhiqo means he gives hard time, okay? Third person, present and future. He will oppress or he oppresses. So here this will apply to the future because now the child is little boy and nothing has happened. But what is he saying? That we feared that. First thing is that. An means that. Okay. And then huma. Huma is used for two people, and these two people are parents. Huma is pointing to abawahu. So he's saying an, and when you read together, you use gunna, ayn. Ayn yurhiqa, the word is ha. Yurhi, original word is yurhiqo, but as I explained that an does one more thing, it changes last letter to a nasab or fatah, so it becomes yurhiqa. That's the word in the Quran. Yurhiqa huma. Ayn yurhiqa huma. That you can bring the meaning might oppress both of them. His parents were mu'minain, they were believers. Fakhashina, so we feared. Ayn yurhiqahuma, that he will oppress both of them. He will make life difficult for both of them. And this is pointing to the future, that when in the future he grows up, now he's a child, he will do these kind of things too. And then he is further giving the reason why he would do that. Because this person's future was destined to be a disbeliever, this boy. So he will do by tughyanam wa kufra. So the root letters is ta, ghain, and ya. This means to rebel or transgress. Okay? And I mentioned the word tughyan is the overflowing of the banks of the river, is crossing the limits. So someone who crosses the limits is Ta, Ghain, and Ya, crosses the boundaries, and that is transgression. So Tughyan, exactly what Tughyan is, the overflowing of the limits of the waters, is called Tughyan. But Tughyan means transgressing, crossing the boundaries. So the word is Tughyanun. So if you make the root letters, it is Tughyanun. When we stop, we say Tughyan. Tughyanun. And the second word is Kufrun. Kafara. And the disbelief is Kufrun. Both of them, or in the original form, have two dhammas at the end. Tughyanun and Kufrun. Rebelling or transgression and disbelief. Disbelief. Both of them are coming as a maful of yurhiqo. So when the word comes as a maful or object, then the last letters, two dhammas change to two fathas on both of them. And whenever we do that, we add an extra alif to pronounce tughyanan and kufran. If we stop, we don't stop at this one, but we stop at this one, we pronounce kufra. Okay? If you stop at tughyanan, then you pronounce tughyana. Okay? So he's saying that we feared that this boy will oppress them, will make difficult for them when he grows up, and by doing two things, he will be rebelling against them, he will be transgressing, and he will be committing the kufr, disbelieving, and that will make the abawahu, his parents, turned into also maybe disbelievers. So by the ilm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given to Khidr, he killed the boy. And then in the next ayat it says that so may Allah will give him a better child than that. And when we do the next one, we'll learn that the Mufassirin say that when this next child was born to these parents, historically it is said that one of the child was a prophet. So wallah alam, but that's a history. So this is the end of these ayats. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to understand the Quran. There are many questions which come in the mind of the scholars, which are, some of them are answerable, some are not. Scholars and mufassirin have taken various steps trying to explain the why answer questions. Some of them are answerable, some of them are not. So inshallah we'll stop that, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this from us. So say the question is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, if you look the tafaseer of this, scholars have struggled very hard to answer the question that why. One of the very important question that comes to the mind, and I'm not going to try to the answer myself, but the scholars say that, for example, why a child in the worldly situation, a punishment should be given after a crime has been committed. Okay, this child has not committed a crime, so there is no justification to punish him. Okay, and they give a lot of explanation, but at the end they say, Wallah Alam, we don't know why it was done that way. There are many ways things can be fixed, but what is destined is destined. What Allah has decided, how something will happen, that is going to happen. Again, there are many, many ways scholars try to answer, justify, but really there is no final answer. We actually have to, you know, just live by saying that it was the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the way it is. So I don't know if Saeed Sahib, I answered your question or not, but this is something very difficult to comprehend. We just have to say this is the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, I'm sure that there are questions in the minds of the people, and I especially read Tafsir by a very famous scholar. He also said, when the word fakhashina is being used, it's a plural. Who are those who are fearing here? Only Khidr is fearing, or there is somebody else who is included in there? Is Musa alayhi salam included? No, he has no idea. Is Allah included in this? No, Allah doesn't fear about anything. So why plural is used instead of saying fakhashiya, I fear that. Fakhashina, we fear that. One explanation which appeals a little bit to the mind of one scholar, he says that when this child was at that age, his mother loved him very much, but his father also noticed that he had some attitude problem at that time. So he also wanted some correction for the child. So can we include his father and Khidr both in this khashina, because that becomes a plural of two. Okay, Wallah Alam, there are no explanations. Okay.